My name is Kathy, and I'm here to talk to you today about my instrument, the French horn, which I've been playing for 52 years. I want to tell you about how it started and how it got to be the instrument that it is today. All horns started as actual horns, animal horns, that were hollowed out and blown into. And whoever started that probably got the first note by accident, and I will show you why. This little guy is a hunting horn. It's just a plain metal tube that's coiled up. Let's see what happens when I blow into it. Pretty much nothing. The only thing you can really hear is the sound of the air going through the horn. And that's because all sound is caused by vibration. Most instruments have something that's either a part of them or that can be attached to them that will make those vibrations. For example, a violin, a harp, a piano, a guitar, all have strings that vibrate to make sound. Woodwind instruments like clarinets, oboes, bassoons, and saxophones have reeds that vibrate to make the sound. But brass instruments like the French horn, the trumpet, the trombone, euphonium, and the tuba have nothing that vibrate. So the musicians themselves have to create those vibrations. And we do that with our lips. I'll show you how to do that. And you can giggle if you want to, because it's going to look pretty funny and it's going to sound pretty funny. But this is what we do. Now, if I take this hunting horn and do the same thing that I just did with my lips, this is what happens. That was one note. Now, in order to change the notes on an instrument like this, you can change it by adjusting the tension of your lips. So I can play maybe four or five notes on this horn, like this. That's one way to change the sound and the notes on a horn. Another way to do that is to change the length of the tubing of the horn. And that's how the first horns were really developed. If you look at my current French horn, and you look right here, you see this piece that moves and comes off. On this horn, this is called the tuning slide, and it makes it easy to get the horn in tune. But on old horns, there was something else that they would put there that was called a crook. Crooks were different lengths of tubing, some of them short, some of them longer, some of them coiled up, that would change the key of the horn, which allowed horn players to play with orchestras more easily because composers would write in all different keys. So, in addition to carrying around their horn, they also had to carry around a separate case full of crooks. If you ever want to see that in real life, the Metropolitan Museum of Art has a full set of early crooks in the musical instrument room. Now, to continue, in 1818, a German invented the rotary valve. The rotary valve is what is on the French horn today. What it does is it reroutes the air as it goes through the horn. If I were to play without pushing a valve like this, the air would go around, and when it gets to all this fancy tubing, it would go straight across without going through any of this tubing. Now, what a rotary valve does, so when you press it down like this, There's a cylinder inside that has holes in it, and those holes will reroute the air through the horn. So if I press this valve down, and this is what happens when I do that, it changes the pitch of the horn, because now the air, instead of going straight through, goes here, and then it comes up into this tube and all the way around and back out. And that's what all these tubes are for. Each tube corresponds to a valve. So that way, the horn can now play all the notes that there are. I have been playing this instrument forever. It's my favorite instrument in the orchestra, and I hope you've learned something new today. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lauren. I play the French horn in the Raritan Valley Symphonic Band. I have been playing the French horn since I was a freshman in high school, or ninth grade. If you saw the flute video last week, the flutes had been playing since they were in fourth grade. Well, I also played the flute in fourth grade, and my high school band director asked me to switch to the French horn. And I said yes, and 15 years later, I'm still playing. So I'm going to show you about all the different parts of the French horn and how to hold the horn. There are many parts to the French horn. The first one is the bell here. And the bell is where all the sound comes out. In the back, we have our main tuning slide. We have many slides around the French horn. So there's one down here, I have one up here, and then you should have three in the front. We also have our valves here. That's where your fingers will go. If you have a double horn, your thumb will have a trigger here. But if you have a single horn, then you should not have that thumb trigger. It should just be a hook there. There's also a finger hook for your pinky, and we also have our valve caps here. So, to put the instrument together, all you need is your mouthpiece, which should be in a hole like this, and then you insert the mouthpiece into our mouthpiece receiver here, which is connected to the lead pipe. Place it in there and just give it one twist. So now it's all together. So I will show you how to hold the instrument. Take your left hand, and your left hand is going to go around the valves here. Your pinky can go right in this ring. Your thumb should have a circle or a ring or a hook so that your thumb can lie comfortably. Now for the right hand. The right hand is going to go inside the bell. Yes, I said it, inside the bell. You're not going to hold it like this or down here. It's going inside. So pretend you're shaking my hand and cup your hand like this. See how it's right inside there? Now I'm going to show you all the different things the French horn is capable of. The French horn has a few different valves. Your thumb valve here, first valve, second valve, and third valve. Valves help us create different sounds. You can also create sounds with just your lips or your embouchure changing, as well as your air speed. The slower your air goes, the lower the sound. The faster your air goes, the higher the sound. I'll demonstrate with what's called the overtone series. I'm not using any valves whatsoever, and I'm only changing my air speed and my embouchure, or my lips. The French horn has a 4-octave range, meaning that the French horn can play low, and the French horn can play high. If you caught our flute video last week, you saw that the flute can do different types of tonguing. Well, so can the French horn. We can single tongue. We can double tongue. We can triple tongue. We can also flutter tongue. That's when you make a rrr sound with your tongue and you play that through the if you ever wanted to be a dinosaur, you totally could with flutter tonguing on the French horn. I would also like to show you different things we can put inside the bell. The first thing is our hand. I talked a little earlier about how to put your hand inside the bell, but we can also put our hand all the way in the bell to make a different sound. Do you hear how buzzy it sounds? There's also what's called a mute that you can put inside of the horn. This is my stopped mute. You put the mute inside of the bell like this, and that's going to help change our sound. It works the same way as putting your hand all the way inside of the bell. There's also what's called a straight mute, and the straight mute goes inside of the bell as well, and it will make our sound a little softer or muted. The French horn is an important member of any ensemble it is played with. Let's first hear the French horn section as a part of the band in Percy Grainger's Lincolnshire Posy. Example of the French horn sound coming to life is made in Beethoven's Third Symphony. Let's hear the Beethoven's Third Symphony French horn trio featuring three French horns playing in harmony together. A French horn isn't just a member of a large ensemble like a band or an orchestra. It can also be a member of a brass quintet featuring trumpets, a French horn, a trombone, and a tuba or a bass trombone. Let's hear the French horn play with a brass quintet featuring the Boston Brass.
Mm-hmm.
French horn play in a woodwind quintet. Yes, woodwind quintet. It is a brass instrument, but since the French horn is so broad in its octave range, it can be played with woodwind instruments. Here we're going to hear Libertango from the Imani Winds Woodwind Quintet, featuring flute, oboe, clarinet, bassoon, and of course, the French horn. Horn in popular music. Check out these rock and roll classics with the French horn. First, we'll hear the Rolling Stones play You Can't Always Get What You Want.
Says her love is dead, you think she needs you. And in her eyes you see nothing.
Hi everyone. So my name is John, and I am one of the trumpet section members of the Raritan Valley Symphonic Band. I'm also the assistant conductor of the ensemble. I'm here to talk to you today about the trumpet. I've been playing the trumpet since I was in fourth grade. I chose the instrument because I loved the way it sounded. I remember listening to movies and watching TV shows with trumpets in them as either sound effects or being played in the movie, and I just loved the way that the trumpet sounded, and that's why I decided to choose the trumpet to play in fourth grade, and I've been playing it ever since. Today we're going to be talking about the trumpet, the origins of the trumpet, how you play it, how you hold it, and we'll show you some demonstrations of what the trumpet sounds like. So the trumpet, in some form, has been around for several thousand years. The old primitive trumpets were very basic instruments, as you can see here from this picture of an ancient trumpet from Peru. Trumpets back then could be made from different materials, including wood, bamboo bark, clay, even human bone could be used to create trumpets. The ancient Greek and ancient Romans used trumpets in wartime, which as a loud instrument were suited very well for that type of music. Also, many European royal households had trumpet ensembles that played military music for them. It wasn't until about the 17th century that the trumpets became part of musical ensembles. At that time, trumpets were only used in their natural form, so the natural trumpet, which is a picture here that you'll see, and they can produce the natural harmonics of the trumpet. So it wasn't quite yet the trumpet that we see today. As you heard from that recording, the trumpet was changing notes and they were pretty high. So around the early 1800s, the valves of the trumpet were created as a way for changing the length of the trumpet to make it a little bit easier to play and to also shrink the size. The valve, as you can see here, is something that changes the path of the trumpet when you're breathing into it or playing the trumpet. So each valve is attached to a slide, which is where the air enters. So it makes the trumpet longer by pressing each valve. So instead of just being able to play, we're now able to play things like this. All those different notes in between, which is pretty cool because now the trumpet can function a little bit more in a musical ensemble. So the trumpet can be played in many different types of ensembles, ranging from classical ensembles in orchestras, to concert bands and military bands, you can also find trumpets in jazz groups. So the trumpet's made up of several parts. We're going to work our way from one side of the trumpet to the other. The first part of the trumpet is called the bell. The bell is where the sound comes out of, and the shape of the bell gives the trumpet its brilliant sound. Working our way over, we have the three valves where our fingers will go, and I show you how to hold the instrument. There are also two slides here that move that correspond with two of our valves. We have the main tuning slide here, which raises or lowers the instrument's pitch so we can play better in tune with the ensemble that we're playing in. And then we also have here the receiver, which is where our mouthpiece goes. And our mouthpiece allows us to play the instrument. So we put our mouthpiece in the receiver like this and give it a little twist so that it locks into place. How we hold our instrument is we first start with our right hand. And I like to think about holding an imaginary baseball so I can get the shape of my hand right. And I want to cut my hand in this C shape. And I want to put my fingers on the three valves. So my pointer finger on top of valve one, my middle finger on top of valve two, and my ring finger on top of valve three. This pinky ring is for where a pinky goes. All right. Sometimes players rest their pinky on top. Some players rest with their pinky inside the pinky ring. Either way is fine. And our thumb of our right hand rests just underneath where the mouthpiece goes in the receiver there. Our left hand, our thumb goes in the thumb ring here. Our two other fingers hug the valves. Our ring finger goes inside the ring hole over here. And our pinky can just kind of rest around here. Some players play with their pinky around there. Some players play with their pinky around here. Just wherever is most comfortable for you. We then bring the trumpet up to our mouth. We never bring ourselves to the trumpet. We always want to play with good posture. So we bring ourselves to the trumpet. And here is what our playing position looks like. Now that we know how to hold the instrument, another member of the trumpet section, his name is Joe, he's going to show you guys how to make a sound on the instrument.
Hi, my name is Joe. And I'm going to talk about how to make a sound with a trumpet. Now, it might seem that all you have to do to make a sound with a trumpet is to blow air through it, but it's actually a little bit more complicated than that. This is what happens when you just blow air through the trumpet. So you can see that I'm really not getting music, I'm just getting noise coming through the trumpet. But what you have to do with a wind instrument in order to get music is to make the air vibrate inside the instrument. Now, if this was a clarinet, which is another when an instrument, you know, you would have a mouthpiece and you would have a little piece of wood inside the mouthpiece called a reed. And as you blow air over the reed would vibrate, and that would start the air inside the clarinet vibrating. But with a trumpet or with another brass instrument, any brass instrument, it's your lips that take the place of the reed. So you have to make your lips vibrate in order to get a sound from the trumpet, like this. Now, once you get your lips vibrating, you can attach your mouthpiece to the trumpet and blow air as your lips are vibrating against the mouthpiece. So with the air vibrating inside the trumpet, I'm able to make music from the trumpet. And that's how to make music with the trumpet.
There are several relatives of the trumpet. Two of those are the flugelhorn and the cornet. They look very similar to the trumpet. The flugelhorn has a bigger bell and produces a bit of a darker tone. The cornet is very similar to the trumpet. It sounds exactly the same. And then we have the piccolo trumpet. The piccolo trumpet is a lot smaller than the regular trumpet and can play notes that are an octave higher than the regular trumpet can. Typically, the piccolo trumpets have four valves. Trumpets, as we know, have three. The fourth valve on the piccolo helps the piccolo trumpet play some lower notes. So now, we're going to play, my friend Lauren and I are going to play a duet together on a song that you might know. It's called the William Tell Overture. Thank you.